How we doing, ladies and gentlemen? Welcome to the 2024 NASCAR playoffs. Holy smokes, I am pumped. I am freaking pumped. The NASCAR playoffs have returned. For those of you who don't know, 2 years ago, I did my, well, for 2022, I did my playoff predictions, and that was essentially my kickstart on YouTube. That was like the first video that really got me into this consistently. And it's one of my favorite videos to make every year. I absolutely love doing my playoff predictions, but I think I got some bold one for you guys today. So without further delay, let's talk the 2024 NASCAR playoffs. Starting off with the round of 16, we head to Atlanta, Watkins Glen, and Bristol. The round of 16 definitely was shaken up with tracks this year, but we're going to focus on the four drivers I have going out of the playoffs. And those four drivers are Harrison Burton, Daniel Suarez, Martin Truex Jr., and Joey Logano. Now, let's talk about this. First one I have out is Harrison Burton. Pretty obvious, unless he wins Atlanta, I do not see Harrison Burton sneaking his way into the next round. I just can't see it. I mean, it's great that the Wood Brothers 21 is here. Happy to see Harrison Burton getting some limelight, but yeah, it's just, I met the guy. That's crazy. Now that I think about it, like, I met just about all of these playoff drivers at New Hampshire other than Cindric and Byron. That's crazy to think about. Shout out that New Hampshire trip, by the way. Go watch my vlog if you haven't watched that already. But yeah, Harrison Burton was one of the cooler dudes. I'm happy he got a win, but that doesn't mean 34th in points should be in the playoffs. Let's sack off when and you're in. Let's change the format to 12 drivers instead of 16. But oh well, we live and we learn. But then, yeah, Daniel Suarez, he is in because of that win at Atlanta. Trackhouse has struggled for speed all year. I will say, if Daniel Suarez can have a good run in Atlanta and Watkins Glen, whoo, baby, look out. Look out for Suarez, I will say that. But yeah, I just can't really see Daniel Suarez going any further. Ross Chastain didn't even make the playoffs, and that was Ross Chastain who everyone would say, looking at Trackhouse, that Chastain would be the number one driver at Trackhouse, not to bring out the F1 references, but still. I just think Daniel Suarez, he's going to be hard-pressed to find speed of that 99. I will be tired. If he doesn't have good runs at Atlanta, Watkins Glen, he's going to have to throw a Hail Mary at Bristol. I will say that. But here's where things get spicy. Martin Truex, I got him going out. Ever since Truex announced his retirement, he's looked awful. He's looked god-awful. And no offense to Martin. I mean, he's had some good runs here and there. I mean, I remember at New Hampshire, he did take the lead for a bit, and I watched him lead for like 25, 50 laps, something like that. He was doing good, but then he just gets taken out every race. It feels like he still pointed his way in by like 60 or some points or whatever, but like the 19 team has just not had the speed. Truex just has not had the same mentality. He's driving like he's already on the fishing boat. So, MTJ, unless something dramatically changes, I will say Watkins Glen is a big, big track for the 19. If they miscue there, that's rough going for Truex. But yeah, I got Truex. And the next driver is Joey Logano. Back-to-back round of 16 exits for Joey Logano, in my opinion. Kind of similar to Martin Truex Jr. This team's just been off. This team has just been very, very off. I remember at the beginning of the year, I put the 22 in the championship four. I thought it was going to be a pretty good year for Ford. And I mean, it wasn't good till Keselowski got that win at Darlington. I mean, Buescher came really close at Kansas, but yeah, it just hasn't been a great year for Ford. And even the one win Logano got at Nashville was because of 5 overtimes. And he was just, well, as some would say, he saved at the pump. But Joey Logano, it just hasn't been the 22's year. And yeah, I just don't see enough consistent speed out of the 22 team compared to these other guys to put him in the round of 12. So unfortunately, I have Joey Logano going out in the round of 16. I will say, with Logano at Atlanta, he either seems to be in the top five or get wrecked out. There's no in-between with Logano, so... I think if Logano doesn't do well at Atlanta, that could be a big, big trouble for Joey Logano. All right, camera focus. There we go. Round of 12. Kansas, Talladega, and the Charlotte Roval. Very, very interesting round. I think this is a pretty bog-standard round, apart from one for me. So, heading to the... Well, going out in the round of 12, I have Chase Briscoe, Alex Bowman, Austin Cindric, and here's the big one, William Byron, out in the round of 12. Well, we'll start off with Briscoe. With Briscoe, I don't think the Stewart Haas Racing has enough speed to keep up at the Roval in Kansas, and so that means their only real shot is Talladega, and just about anything can happen at Talladega, and yeah. Great for Briscoe. I'm glad the 14 could get one more win before it heads off into the sunset. A boy just like me, a diehard Tony Stewart fan, he was just lucky to grow up in Indiana, the same state as Tony, but yeah, I think this is where the road ends for Chase Briscoe and the 14 team. Alex Bowman, the 48. Haven't seen speed since Pocono, really. The summer break was the worst thing that happened to the 48 team, in my opinion. They finally got some good momentum going with that win at Chicago. And, they got a third at Pocono, I remember that. But, yeah, ever since the summer break, the 48 team has been pretty much non-existent. So, I think Alex Bowman, he's in a Hendrick car. He's got enough speed to make the round of 12. I think he can definitely beat some of the guys who I got out in the round of 16. But I just can't see him advancing any further. Sorry, Bowman. But Austin Cindric, here's an interesting one. I honestly think the playoffs, like the first two rounds of the playoffs, shape up very well for Austin Cindric. But I just think he's going to have too many points to make up. Austin Cindric's a great super speedway and road course guy. And Austin Cindric, he needed that win at Gateway. He was in the right position at the right time, but fuel strategy ended up benefiting him greatly at Gateway. So Austin Cindric, I've got going out in the round of 12. I just think it's too many points for someone of Cindric's caliber to make up. And then William Byron. Oh, this one's going to turn a lot of heads. I've got William Byron out in the round of 12. William Byron, man, honestly, you could make an argument that he's going out in the round of 16, but the only time I've seen William Byron have speed in the summer was, where was it? Iowa. And that's when he finished second. Other than that, the 24 may be starting in the top 10, but just falls back every single time. I don't know what happens to Byron. I really don't know what happens to William Byron. And it's almost like it just fades right off. And I mean, for someone of William Byron's caliber, you can't be, even for any of these drivers, you can't be going in to, you can't be going into the playoffs with absolutely no momentum. And the 24 has absolutely no momentum. I mean, Byron did have speed at Michigan, to be fair. That was like Byron's only good run since Iowa. And even before Iowa, I think his only good run before that was Martinsville, but it's just like, the 24 team's built enough playoff points and they run consistently enough to get into the round of 12, but I just can't see that 24 team going any further. They're going to have to turn some serious heads and grab some big momentum real quick in those first couple races. And I mean, in 2023, William Byron absolutely dominated Watkins Glen. So I'm looking at Watkins Glen for William Byron, but yeah, I don't think it's going to be a good year for William Byron and the 24 team personally. All right, going out in the round of 8, I have the 54 of Ty Gibbs, the 6 of Brad Keselowski, the 9 of Chase Elliott, and the 11 of Denny Hamlin. All right, where do we start here? Let's start with Ty Gibbs. He's the first driver I have out. Just not as fast as all the other guys up here. I mean, I do think Ty Gibbs has definitely put more of a complete season together than, most people ahead of him. I mean, he's had a great points campaign. He's improved a lot from his rookie year. So a lot more consistently running in higher positions. Ty Gibbs, I really think, has had a decent season. But he's that guy, in my opinion, who there's always one of the lower seeds, like 10 through 16, who just manages to sneak their way through to the round of 8. And the way these tracks work out, I honestly think they fit into Ty Gibbs' skill set very well. Other than Atlanta and Talladega, I think a lot of these tracks fit into Ty Gibbs' skill set. So I've got Ty Gibbs going into the round of 8, but I just don't see him advancing any further unless he does what he did in Xfinity 2 years ago, which I hope he doesn't, but he might just. Oh well. Brad Keselowski, I've got second driver out. Just not enough consistent speed. I mean, with RFK, they're either like way the hell up here running or they're way the hell back here running, and sometimes they're just in the middle. I really like Brad Keselowski. I think that RFK number 6 is a really good dark horse pick for this championship this year. I think Brad Keselowski is a very good dark horse for the championship this year. Can he do it? Absolutely. But I'm just not seeing enough consistent pace out of the 6 car to genuinely affirm that he's going into the round of 4. To the championship 4, so yeah, sorry for Brad, but I just don't see any way further. And the same thing goes for Chase Elliott. Him and Brad Keselowski have been really good point scorers throughout the season. Chase Elliott back in the playoffs after his injury last year, got a big win at Texas, but like the 9 always has top 5, top 10 speed, but where's the wins? That's what I want to see. I want to see at least one or two more wins for Chase Elliott. Watkins Glen, very good track for Chase Elliott. I've had like 8 drivers who I've said Watkins Glen's a good track for. But we know how good Elliott is on road courses. Not so much in the next gen car, but Elliott will get a road course win one of these days. But he's always been up there, and I mean, I think he could do really good at Kansas, Talladega, and Charlotte. I believe in that Kansas spring race he finished 3rd, I want to say, and the Roval, that was really Chase Elliott's playground before the Gen 7 car. So yeah, I think the playoff tracks suit Elliott well, but I feel like he would need a win in the round of 8 to make sure he gets a spot in the championship 4, and I just don't see that for Elliott. And one spot short of the championship 4, once again, DH Denny Hamlin. Denny Hamlin would have been in my final 4 if there wasn't no penalty. That penalty is going to hurt that 11 car, and plus that 11 team is not a team in championship form. Their last win was in Dover at the end of April. That's not the championship form I want to see from Denny Hamlin. I mean, I personally think Denny Hamlin, I think he's winning a championship at some point, but this year just doesn't feel like the year. Last year felt like the year for me and Denny Hamlin, especially after that Bristol win. It felt like last year was the year, but what was it at Homestead? That brake failure at Homestead last year, that's what screwed Denny Hamlin out of a championship, in my opinion. I think he would have went and gave those guys a good run at Phoenix, but that really screwed Denny Hamlin, in my opinion. But yeah, he'll be more great drama on Netflix this year if 2311 actually allows the access, but well, 2311 and Denny. But yeah, I just can't see Denny advancing any further, unfortunately. I just can't see it. But yeah, final 4, y'all already know who it is. And I mean, another point with Denny is just, yeah, no championship form, no extra bonus points. And I mean, yeah, it just, ever since, like, June, luck has not fallen the 11's way, so I can't see Hamlin getting the championship 4 with what I've seen so far in 2024. So there you have it. That leaves my final 4 to be Kyle Larson, Christopher Bell, Tyler Reddick, and Ryan Blaney. Now you can make a case for all of these guys, in my opinion. Kyle Larson, the fastest guy, week in, week out. But I think Kyle Larson's worst enemy is himself. I really do think that, because, I mean, the 5 car is always up near the front every single week. It's almost impossible to stop that 5 car some weeks, but they just get in their own way. Larson gets in his own way. I mean, Michigan's one that comes to mind, and Homestead last year, that's another one that comes to mind. That 5 car is always in the top 5, but if Larson just tones it back a little bit, if Cliff Daniels gets in his ear and says, okay, just stay focused, don't lose control of the car or whatever, he just gets in Larson's ear a little bit, I think Kyle Larson is a championship favorite. I really do. That 5 car is just too damn good. And I can't remember how they did at Phoenix in the spring. I honestly can't remember, but if you remember if you remember what happened in the Phoenix spring race, that's going to lead into my championship pick, but we'll continue on. Ryan Blaney, here is another good option. The Fords are always good at Phoenix. They clean sweeped the championships last year because they were at Phoenix, and Ford just knows how to come up clutch in like August through what? November. They always do it. I don't know how Ford does it, but every single year it's how they do it. And it's just like, how did you do this? Your car sucked all year and then you get 3 wins and now you're champions. Like, how did this happen? But to be fair to Blaney, he's won at pretty similar tracks to Phoenix. I mean, obviously that Iowa win was a big one for the 12 team. That was the first win of the season. He got a win at Pocono too, which, I mean, one of the corners is kind of shaped like, honestly, the Pocono corners are kind of shaped like Phoenix corners, like banking wise and everything. They're just a little bigger and faster. So yeah, Blaney's definitely a championship favorite. And then we got Christopher Bell. Bell obviously won the Phoenix race earlier in the year, has been the king of the flat tracks. I remember at Gateway, it was nonstop him versus Blaney. The only reason them two didn't win the race, because Bell had an engine failure, and Blaney ran out of gas in the last lap. So yeah, that was Gateway for you. And I mean, obviously Bell won at New Hampshire. Bell's won so many. Bell's just the king of the flat tracks, man. He's so good. I mean, he got a win at the Coke 600 earlier this year too, so he's always been up there. He hasn't been good enough to go steal the regular season championship, but it's not like he's far out of it. He's been in like that 5th through 8th range all year. Like, Bell's been close, and he's going into the playoffs with the second most playoff points too. And a lot of people like to sleep on Christopher Bell, so I think this is the year that changes. But we have to talk about Tyler Reddick, regular season champion, 45, first championship 4 appearance for the 45 in Tyler Reddick. In my opinion, I think Tyler Reddick is dead set for a championship 4 this year. He's been the most consistent driver every week. There was a point there in the summer where I'm pretty sure he didn't finish outside, like, since I want to say New Hampshire, he hasn't finished lower than like 5th other than a super speedway, which is nuts. That's absolutely nuts to think about. Let's think about it. He got 3rd at Nashville, 2nd at Chicago. I think he finished like 4th at Pocono, and then it was 2nd at Indy, and then he was in the top 5 at Richmond, 1 Michigan. Daytona wasn't really there, but Darlington, I'm pretty sure he finished inside the top 10 too, even when he was throwing up and stuff. It was like, holy crap, man, Tyler Reddick is an absolute animal this year. And I mean, 2311's giving him the fast cars, and he's definitely taking advantage of it, to say the least. I really do think Tyler is a big, big, big benefit to 2311 Racing. And yeah, here's the thing for me and Reddick though, is I haven't seen the pace from Reddick at Phoenix since he left RCR, which is interesting. I will say that, because I mean, nowadays you think the Toyotas had the more speed at Phoenix, but all right. But anyway, let's get into my championship pick. Kyle Larson, Ryan Blaney, Christopher Bell, Tyler Reddick. First of all, I'm not taking Kyle Larson. Why? Because he's his own worst enemy, and I just don't see him having the speed of the Toyotas and the Fords at Kansas. Third place, Tyler Reddick. Haven't seen the speed, speed at flat tracks at least. And this is what happens when it comes down to a one race winner take all format. So Tyler Reddick third, he's had the speed all year. Him or Larson probably should be the champion, but there's still 10 races to go and we need a new format. That's a topic for another day though. You'll probably see that in my post-race Phoenix review in a couple months, but excuse me. Ryan Blaney, second place. Ford are great. Ryan Blaney is great. He's great at flat tracks. He's great at short ovals. They really blend well into his skill set, but I can't see him beating the 20 man. I really do think it's the 20's year. Hell, I even told Christopher Bell I've got money on him winning the championship. I told him I put it on him in like February. I'm like, dude, like, you're the man to win this championship, Christopher Bell. This year is just screaming Christopher Bell to me. Who did I predict? Who have my last two predictions been for these playoff videos? I'm pretty sure I predicted Larson in 22. And he went out in the round of 12. And then I had Truex in 23. He went out in the round of 8. And hopefully Christopher Bell can change my luck this year. Third time is the charm. I really do think, especially with the new Toyota body, they can absolutely fly around Phoenix. And I just think Christopher Bell is the lock to win this year's championship. I think it'll be close between him and Blaney, but it's hard to not overlook C. Bell in this situation. Christopher Bell is my pick to win the NASCAR Cup Series Championship in 2024. Leave your championship winner in the comments down below. What do you agree with in my picks? What do you disagree with? Please let me know down below. Subscribe to follow along. I will be doing post-race reviews for every race throughout the playoffs. Subscribe and notifications turned on so you don't miss them. And yeah, guys, I will see you, if you just watch these kinds of videos, I will see you in November for the Championship 4 picks. Take care and peace.